Lord, I'm asking you to deliver sin.
Thank you. All to go, they want us to come, so if you would, they'd be glad to have us. Praise God. Well, I'm going to be going to the book of Philippians chapter 3. I want to be turning there. But I'm going to start out with verse 17, 18 and 19. So, Philippians chapter 3, verses 17, 18, and 19 to start with.
Hallelujah.
Rehashing the message I preached before. The problem with me doing that is it usually gets longer. Anyway, Philippians chapter 3, verse 17. Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk, as ye have us for an example. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you, even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. And you can be seated. But my subject is the enemies of the cross of Christ. The first time I read that, I thought, who are these enemies? And your mind starts going to all kinds of things. But I'm going to back up for a minute, kind of lay some groundwork, and I'm going to go back up to verse 13. And then I'm going to read on down through verse 16. Verse 13 says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, and reaching forth unto those things which are before. Sometimes when Paul is writing, it's kind of hard to understand. You know, sometimes it's kind of like reading one of them insurance forms, and they've got all these words before us and all these other words in there. You wonder what they mean. But I'm going to read this again in the Bible in Basic English. Verse 13 said, brothers, it is clear that I have not come to that knowledge. Now, what knowledge he's talking about is us coming to the knowledge and the fullness of Christ, that we might become full-grown Christians. Okay? Adult, spiritually. Hallelujah. But one thing I do, letting go those things which are past, and stretching out to the things which are before. I don't know how many people I've heard make statements about they're discouraged by their past failures. You know, sometimes they're hung up on their past victories to the point they just want to ride that for all it's worth. But we're not supposed to stay in one place or we'll stagnate. The devil would like for you to dwell on all the mistakes you've ever made, to dwell on your failures, to look back in the past and then look toward the future and say, I can't do it. But that's not true. The Apostle Paul himself said, you got to forget those things behind you and keep stretching forth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To the things which are before. Verse 14 said, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus. And most of the time I hear people teach this like this is the calling of God into the ministry. I don't really believe that's what it is. It is to an extent. But there is no higher calling than to be called to be a child of God. Man, that's the ultimate. All the people in this world, some of them don't got a clue. Some of them think they're living for God and they're on the broad way. But there's a few. Many are called, but few are chosen. There's no greater call than to be a child of God, to be able to call Him Dad. Hallelujah. But, hallelujah. Verse 15 says, let us, therefore, as many as be perfect. Stop right there for a second. We're to press forward to the mark. And like I've already said, we can't stand still. All right? But let us, therefore, as many as be perfect. Now, what's he talking about here? There's none perfect. No, not one. Jesus himself said that. So what's he talking about here? Okay, I'm just going to read this, okay, in verse 15 of the Bible in Basic English. It said, let us all who have come to full growth. He's talking about spiritual growth. You're not going to be perfect as a human. Our righteousness is as filthy rags. But you can come from a babe to an adult spiritually. And it doesn't mean once you reach adulthood that it's over. You don't have to do anything else. There's a constant growth in you. Our faith can be increased. Our ability to live for God, to listen to God, to obey His commands. All these things can keep going. God does not want us to stay where we were yesterday. We're not making it up the mountain. Hallelujah. But when we come to full growth, be of this mind, and if in anything you are of a different mind, even this will God make clear to you. David prayed the prayer. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. See whether there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. He realized, like we need to realize, that God knows us better than we know ourselves. And what he's saying is, as we're striving for perfection spiritually, if we're going the wrong way, God's going to show us. If we need to go in another direction, God's going to show us. Hallelujah. He wants us to grow. And he usually shows us in ways we understand. Hallelujah. I don't want to just stagnate. Hallelujah. He has been so good to me. Hallelujah. Verse 15 in the Bible, King James Version says, let us therefore as many as be perfect, be thus minded, and if in anything ye be otherwise minded, God shall reveal it to you, even this unto you. And the problem, and I'm going to kind of touch on this a little bit before I really get into it, is as new converts, it's hard to get away from the world. The mentality of the world, the way the world thinks, the world's morals, the world's decoration. Hallelujah. It's hard for us to get away from that. And he's talking to Gentiles here, and even Jews who were used to the law, and now the law has been fulfilled. And it's a new law written in the tables of our heart. And they have trouble getting over that. You read stories in the Bible, they're trying to force the Gentiles to get circumcised, all kind of different things like this that keep coming up. You know, it was because they were having that trouble making the transition. And for someone to think that when you come into church, there's not going to be a transition, there is. I know people that have had trouble with things. I've heard people who testify that, you know, I have not a desire one time to get in and have any more drugs or alcohol or cigarettes, but I know people that really had to struggle trying to smoke. Smoking cigarettes or some of these other things. It was a battle. And even in our walk with God, as time goes on, we get to the point where the Bible's talking about being perfected or fully grown spiritually. The battles aren't over. The devil's going to try to throw things up at you. And sometimes we're just going to have to pray and fast and seek God until we can overcome that thorn in the flesh, so to speak. Hallelujah. And verse 16 says, nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. And let us mind the same thing. You know, if a man individually can't be double-minded, or he's unstable in all his ways, as the body of Christ collectively, we can't be double-minded. You know, let us walk by the same rule. I know there's differences. You know, one preacher might say something about how he wants all the women to have their hair down, so folks can see that we believe in all women having their hair uncut. And another preacher might say, I want all women to have their hair up. And there was reasons for these things. If you go back and look, you know, why these things were done at some time, back in the 70s, they wanted a lot of the women in those areas to wear their hair up because they didn't want the women to be associated with the hippie women that had their hair down long. You know, there's reasons. And God has given that place of authority to the ministry. I use the story of Moses who gave them, you know, the bill of writing a bill of divorcement for the separation from the wives. Jesus plainly said that wasn't his will from the beginning. Man left his father and mother and cleaved unto his wife. But did God send all these other patriarchs that were guilty of the same thing to hell? No, he honored it because the man of God said it. But Jesus straightened it out when he said, because of the hardness of your hearts. He allowed it. But I'm telling you, it don't need to be that way anymore. Hallelujah. So, just as an example, God did give a place of authority to the ministry. Which will be bound on earth, shall be bound in heaven. Which will be loosed on earth, shall be loosed in heaven. He wasn't telling Peter and the apostles that they could be supreme dictators. Hallelujah. Some things you're going to have to pray about, make decisions on your own, and I'll honor it. Hallelujah. That's why I've always said, my pastor tells me to do something, I do it because I know God will honor it. More than if I try to be rebellious. You know, when Kevin was little, he asked me a question if I believed everything Brother Price teaches. We were going to church. I said, well, son, if I don't, I'm not going to tell you about it. Because I don't want to have a rebellion. Hallelujah. The spirit of rebellion. Rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness as iniquity and idolatry. I don't celebrate Christmas. So probably not. Nothing new to any of you. But we went to Fairview Church, and every year they had a Christmas dinner, they called it. Sometimes they call it a yearly church supper. That was because we were there, I guess. But they exchanged gifts. So, well, what did you do? I said, I exchanged gifts. Well, how can you do that? Say you don't celebrate Christmas. I said, well, what's better? To exchange a gift, which doesn't hurt nothing. You know, we're not giving out Christmas cards. We're not putting Christmas wrapping on it. You know, you bring a gift as a man, and they exchange it. Another man has one, and then you take numbers, and you see what you wind up with. And they kind of made fun out of it, you know, because once you got one, if you got a number, and you run up there, and somebody else had something, you can go take their gift. You know, and it wound up back and forth, and sometimes, you know, it just wound up fun. But someone said, well, how can you do that? And I said, what's better, to exchange a gift or teach my children to rebel against their pastor? What's better? Explain to them, but we have to put Christmas presents on it, you know. We put Christmas cards and all these things. Hallelujah. It's just a gift. Someone said, well, you know, what about a factory when they take out the collection? You get a gift from the boss. I give. Those people don't understand why I'm on Christmas, you know, or how I got there from here. But, you know, what's better to cause reproach? Those people really believe that that's Jesus' birthday. It's easier just to chip in on the gift and keep working on it until you get them to church and get them filled with the Holy Ghost and let God reveal some of these things. Praise God. Hallelujah. I want to do what's right in God's eyes. Hallelujah. But we need to mind the same thing. I understand there's differences in what's on the But the plan of salvation, we need to understand there is no other plan. You can't go to the Alamo Church that teaches another plan of baptism, another plan of salvation, another way to do this or that. That's not according to the Word of God. And that's what Paul was talking about. And when he said to follow me as I follow Christ. Praise God. There don't need to be multiple plans of salvation. It don't work. And I've touched on that enough times. I mean, times they can get going. But a lot of times, people tend to think of Paul as a hard preacher. And he did preach it. Preach it just like it is. Some people can't handle that. You know, I always like Brother Copper. You ask him a question, he'll tell you. Don't ask him if you didn't want to know the truth, because he was going to tell you. Hallelujah. But my mom was a lady like that. She's going to tell you. You ask her, you're going to hear it. You know, and I grew up used to that. So I appreciate that. When I go ask somebody something, they just tell me how they feel. Well, it might hurt somebody's feelings, but I'd rather know if I'm hurting their feelings. Or you don't want me at your house. You know, I go to people's houses, folks I don't know, we're over there visiting, and sometimes, you know, you get to fellowshipping and you'll stay too long. I said, look, when you get ready to obey, you tell me it's time for me to leave. You know, I'm not going to get my feelings hurt. I'd rather you tell me when you're ready to go to bed than have me sit here and keep you up and when he's going to leave. But I can have my mouth. And I've had somebody tell me, well, I'm glad you said that, because I am ready to go to bed. I said, all right, we'll see you, bro. Hallelujah. I'd rather know. You know, if people would just communicate, there'd be a lot less problems. Don't have your feelings stuck out there on your shoulder all the time. Hallelujah. But Paul was compassionate, preacher. Hallelujah. He cared. Hallelujah. Paul is confident in the truth, and he's willing to preach it no matter what. But at the same time, he feels compassionate for those who reject the gospel. And if you think of the story of Paul and his zeal, he persecuted the Christians, had them thrown in jail, forced some of them to denounce Christ. Men, women, and children, some of them were even put to death as a result of his what he thought was part of the ministry of God. And so you can imagine how he feels when he realizes he caused these people to sin. So there's a compassion there that we might not realize for these souls that are lost. And we need to have that kind of burden when we minister to somebody, when we preach to somebody, when we try to get them to come to church. You know, and they just can't see this. There needs to be a love there. Bless God, I've done the food. You know, we got to be compassionate in how we reach other people. Hallelujah. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 4, out of much affliction and anguish of heart, I wrote unto you with many tears. This is Paul writing. Not that ye should be grieved. He doesn't want to make them sad, you know, so much. But that ye might know the love which I have more abundantly unto you. People can take a lot from you if they know you care. People aren't going to listen to you until they realize you care. You can't just go up and start telling folks, yeah, you need to get taught right, you know, quit saying, you know, you're going to go to hell if you don't. They first need to realize you care. You need to be a friend to somebody. And once they realize you do care, they'll listen to what you have to say. Hallelujah. Paul's man had great love for the lost. And I like what Brother Verbal Bean used to say. He said, preach against sin and preach it hard, but always leave a way out. They need to know that there's a way to escape the penalty of sin. Hallelujah. Who are these enemies of the cross? So back to that verse, which is really my main point. My mind just started whirling, you know, and I thought, Antichrist, you know? Well, yeah. To some extent, the atheist? Trinitarians preaching a false doctrine? Devil worshippers? You know, you think all these different things. But who are these enemies of the cross of Christ? Hallelujah. It's not just these. These fight against the cause of God. But there's a worse enemy, church. Hallelujah. Who are they? Sitting in our pews. I'm not talking about anybody particular in this building, but I'm talking about in the church as a whole. There are tares among the wheat. And I hear people say, well, I'm not going to church there. They got hypocrites over there. Well, you know, it don't matter where you go. There's always going to be some hypocrites. And I like one man said one time, he said, well, that hypocrite is closer to God than you are. Well, how do you figure that? He said, because they're standing between you and God. Go to church and get your heart right with God. God's not going to tear them out. We think, why didn't God tear them out? Why don't he, you know, kill them off or whatever? God has compassion. God loves. And he said, if I tear some of these out, I'm going to tear up some of the wheat with them. Your life affects somebody else. And even if they're just claiming to be what they're supposed to be, and they're not, it's still going to affect somebody when that one's jerked out. Hallelujah. So God doesn't do it that way. But the damage that's done by someone who, by all appearances, seems like they're saved, they serve God, they kind of turn their kind of towards the rules, they pay their tithes, they do this, they do that, and they're church workers. I got news for you and me as well. That doesn't mean you're saved. If God gives you a miracle and heals you of cancer, that doesn't mean you're saved. Well, why would God do that if I wasn't saved? Because God loves. Because faith touches God. Hallelujah. God wants you to know that he loves you enough that he cares. And that's how he draws you closer to him. The problem is so many people are tricked by the devil into thinking, well, if God done a miracle for me, I'm saved. If God allowed me to speak in tongues, I'm saved. I'm sorry. I've seen people that had nowhere near being in church speaking in tongues. All they were faking. No, they wasn't. I've seen people speak in tongues when I knew and could feel it was from the devil. But I've seen people speak in tongues in times when they were grieved, when they were calling out to God. And I've seen it happen, church. But it doesn't mean you're saved. You still have to obey the truth. I've said it before. Truth sets the boundaries for mercy. Mercy can go no farther than truth allows. If you have to repent of your sins, be baptized in Jesus' name, and filled with the Holy Ghost to be saved, when mercy comes trying to run up there and save them anyway, he's hitting a wall of truth. Uh-uh. This has to be complied with first. Hallelujah. So we need to realize we need to do it by the book. Jesus says, they that believe on me as what? The scripture has said. Hallelujah. It's got to be right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So who are they? In the verse of scriptures we read said their God is their belly or self-satisfaction. They're driven by selfishness and self-satisfaction. It's all about me. You know, most of the problems we have come from selfishness. Whether in church or out of church, whether it's in family or out of the family, they stem from selfishness because we want to have it our way. I want it my way. And I had problems, you know, when I first got in church, you know, and something was being given away. I didn't get there before he does. I mean, if I want to get it, I'm going to have to. This is the natural. And God had to check me. That's the wrong mentality. God has promised to supply all our needs according to his riches and glory. I don't need that. And God showed me that again and again. I don't have to be the one that gets it first. Hallelujah. That's why the Bible tells us to prefer our brother. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter who gets it. You know, it's like playing games and stuff like that. People get so caught up in having to be the one that wins. Then they may be a good sport, you know, if they lose. But I used to get really worked up about it. I'd argue with people and don't know. Brother Bobby came up to me one time and he told me, of course, he was captain of our team playing volleyball. He said, it's just a game, Mom. You know, it doesn't matter who wins. He said, when you argue, it's making it miserable for everybody. You know, I shut up, but I still had problems with it. But the more I thought about it, the more I prayed about it, the more, and then I realized he's right. What does it matter? How many ideas to get together? I say such a yesterday. We had to get together around. And almost everybody in the whole family made it there. We couldn't go into a room in the house hardly, and there wasn't a crowd of people in there. I grilled a bunch of stuff on the grill, and everybody brought dishes, and we just had a party. I could see Mom walking around. Every room she goes into, she's just got a big smile on her face. She liked having that big crowd there. Hallelujah. That's what's important. Let there be love. Hallelujah. And there's preachers who will not preach the whole counsel of God because of fear, what someone might think, or favor from a certain group or individual. You can't allow that to influence you. Hallelujah. People need to be saved. And when you are not, as a minister, preaching what God tells you to preach, you are becoming an enemy of the cross of Christ. Because when God gives you a word for somebody, and you don't deliver it, watchman on the wall story. If they wind up lost because of that, their blood is on your hands. Hallelujah. Go around setting the wrong example, you're setting a stumbling block before people. And that's going to cause people to be lost. I don't want that to be the case. Okay, in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but it's of the world. That's what I'm talking about, trying to get that mentality out of our head. We're new people. You know, in a proselyte conversion in the Old Testament, everything they knew before they became a Jew was done and over with. Everything. They had no bonds to their old family. They got a new family. And when you get in church, there's some of us can testify, You became an enemy of your family almost, because you adopted a new family. We adopted a heavenly father, and there needs to be changes. But as a result, a lot of us try to straddle that fence back and forth so we can fit in here. You know, I was fortunate enough, and my family pretty well accepted me as I was. They understood when they came over to the house, you know, come all the way from Florida to visit me. Then they show up on Sunday, and I'm going to church. Sorry. You know, God is more important. And it bothered some of them at first, but they got used to it. When I got back out of church, I said, you can always come with me. And I wound up getting some of them to come with me. My mom and dad, my sisters. Hallelujah. Who knows what God will do? But sometimes God puts us to the test. Who's first? I don't want to be your enemy, God. Hallelujah. Who's first? Hallelujah. The world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God will abide forever. Not just in this life. Eternity. Hallelujah. They glory in their shame. Hallelujah. They call good evil and evil good. That's a danger. I know we see it more and more in this day and time we live in. Nancy Pelosi with her stepping down speech talked about how they had more women and blacks and gays and the LGBTQ crowd and all this different stuff, you know, in the House of Representatives than they've ever had before. That ain't good. There's nothing wrong. I've got no problem with blacks. You know, I love the black people. I told somebody the other day, talking, I said, I wasn't raised with any kind of prejudice. When I meet somebody from a different culture, I want to know all about it. Especially, you got any kind of dishes that I've never had before? What about a recipe we can try, you know? I'm interested in that stuff. I don't want to have problems. But now, when they start doing things that are ungodly, and they're trying to lead our country astray, we don't need that, church. When they start telling you that all these things that God says are evil, that they're really good, there's something wrong. I don't want that. Hallelujah. I don't want to adopt that mentality. They glory in their shame. What the Bible said, Romans 1:28. And I've used these verses of scriptures for quite a few different things. But it said, even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. God did not make them reprobate. God's not going to make you reprobate, but if you have that reprobate mind, God's going to turn you over to it if you don't repent. If you don't heed his nudges to turn around and go in the right direction, it says he gave them over to a reprobate mind. They already had this mind. To do those things which are not convenient. But being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death. The way of every man is right in his own eyes. Well, I can see your problem, Brother Don. But I can't see mine. And he might look at me and say, oh, he's got a problem. That's why Jesus said, oh, for me. Some people say that. Gagged and strained at a gnat, gagged on the camel, you know. Same principle. We tend to make everything we do right, and it's not that way. We need to judge ourselves by the book. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. But I stopped there about the word of death, but here's the rest of that verse. not only those that do the same. He said, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. You bragging and carrying on about what somebody else did that was wrong? Hallelujah. I don't need to be encouraged. I remember as a kid, I'm rambling on, I'm probably going to cut this short and wind up doing the rest of it this evening. But I remember as a young boy, a friend of mine, Mark Williams, we were best friends in school. You know, second, third grade. I think it was third grade. We were walking down the whole sidewalk with door arms around each other, man. We were just, you know, we were buddies. That term buddy has turned into something else. First time someone said, what are you guys, queer men, running your arms around each other? But, you know, I ain't heard nothing much about this, but they get this stuff, you know? And I've seen it to the point to where, you know, it was disgusting. People didn't want nothing to do with it. They didn't want these people in their neighborhood. They tried to run them out. You know, it was utterly rejected. And then they started making fun of them. I'm talking about over time. I'm seeing this. They started making fun of them. And as they start making a joke out of this, time goes on, you get desensitized to it. Until you get to the point of all the heat is on, just completely want it. And then they're accepting everything. It follows that pattern with everything. Everything the devil tries to get us involved in follows that pattern. He don't just show up in front of your face and say, hey, how would you like some marijuana? Or how would you like try LSD or something like that? He'll start you out getting hooked on prescription drugs. He'll start getting, you know, some way or another, he'll do gradual, step-by-step process until you get from here to there. And when you look at the beginning, all the way down the end, say, how in the world did I get here from there? And that's what the devil does to try to trip us up. Hallelujah. Said they mind earthly things. Verse 32, a lot for preaching against Hollywood. Well, I just watch Disney movies. You mean like The Runaways? Kids being disobedient to parents? You can say, oh, it's all done, you know, fun, it's all me. You know, it's not. It puts ideas in kids' heads and in people's heads. I've said it before, you're watching stuff on these movies and stuff. And then you wind up in a similar situation, you wind up reacting the way you've seen somebody else react. Hallelujah. You start thinking in your mind about people that cuss and things they say. You get this stuff in your head and then something happens and it comes out. Someone told me, said, I know Brother Henson, he's a real preacher. I've seen him mash that thumb again and again, till blood squirting out of him. I never once heard him say a cuss word. Because he didn't have that stuff in his head. But they used to tell me, don't even use slangs. You know, good God. Just different stuff like that. Why am I saying the actual word? I just use the word crazy. You know? If you get that stuff in your head, if you make a practice out of doing that, when something happens and you mash that thumb, the real thing is going to come out. Sister Glenda got me about that when I first got in church. Glenda last night. She's another one. Just tell it to you. Hallelujah. It's good sometimes. Hallelujah. We wonder how people react. Sometimes it's good. They mind earthly things. They're too earthly minded to be of any heavenly good. Romans chapter 8 and verse 5. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh. But they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. And the principle is explained in verse 6. Jeremy, if you would, just go ahead and let me know. But for to be carnally minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. And I've explained this before. Carnal, carnally minded, worldly minded have almost the exact same definition, and they both include the decoration, the mentality, and the morals of the world. So you don't want to have the mentality that you still want to look like the world, you still want to act like the world, you still want to fit in with the world, because to be carnally minded is dead. He's not saying that if you wind up with that carnal mind that's going through your head, that I'm going to snuff you out right there. That's not what he's saying. You are on a broad way that's going to lead to destruction, is what he's saying. To be carnally minded is death. It's going in the wrong direction. But to be spiritually minded, that straight and narrow way, is life and peace. Well, you know, there's so many things in this world that I want. You know, I'm not happy with this, I'm not happy with that. I'm going to tell you, some of these poor people out in these third world countries are much happier than we are. We complain about some of the things that we don't have. And I've told my children when they were little, I said, there's a lot of people over there in the Philippines and Brazil that would love to have your poverty. Yeah, you eat them turnip greens, they'd love to have them. Hallelujah. Lord, help me. Help me, Lord. Be spiritually minded. That's why they used to say, if you look for God hard with everything you got, it's easy. In other words, if you live for God spiritually, it's easy. If you live for God carnally, it's going to be hard. It's going to be constant battle. Because there's always things coming up. Hallelujah. Verse 7 says, because the carnal mind is enmity or extreme hatred, is how it defines in English, against God. How is being carnally minded mean that I have an extreme hatred for God? Because God's going to reject you until you quit that. God is not going to put up with that. He hates that. And I've explained before, the devil is referred to as the God of this world. And the principles and the morals and the mentality that are in this world are set up by him. Hallelujah. Refers to him as the prince of the power of the air. He's given a space and time where he has authority in this world. And Jesus already said, his kingdom is not of this world. His kingdom that's in this world is in us. It's not in this world. Hallelujah. And God wants us to come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. And I will receive you. Hallelujah. He don't want carnally minded. He don't want worldly minded. You're separating yourself from God. The carnal mind is enmity against God, for he is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. You can't. We've got to live in this world. We've got to function in this world. We are flesh and blood. Hallelujah. But the reason they that are in the flesh can't please God is because in the flesh all righteousness is filthy God, filthy righteousness. But it does please the Father when we're obedient. And we subject ourselves to him. Hallelujah. I want to be pleasing in the eyes of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to stop right there. Hallelujah. Sister Rose, if you would. Come on to the music. This is some songs things, right? Praise God. Hallelujah. I've got about 2.5 pages more notes. I'm going to deal with this. The enemies of the cross of Christ. I don't want God counting me as an enemy. Hallelujah. Praise God. Of course, I'm yours, Lord, everything I got. I'm yours, Lord, everything I got, everything I am. I'm Lord, now you know you got me in a bad time here. God knows what time you're in. Hallelujah. Do we really love God more than anything else? Scripture, Jesus asked me, lovest thou me more than these? Do you love me more than my friends? Do you love me more than your family? Do you love me more than your official business? Hallelujah. My number one in your life, you can honestly say, I'm completely yours, Lord. Hallelujah. And if we can't, we need to be striving for that perfection the Apostle Paul talked about. Praise God. Well, I'm glad for everyone that's here this morning. I thank God for an opportunity to be in his house. I'm going to go ahead and dismiss Iron Hill. But they want everyone that will come, so don't feel bad about going. Hallelujah. We'll invite them back over here and have a game night with us or something. Hallelujah. Lord's been good to us. So let's pray. And we'll be dismissed in Jesus' name. Lord, we love you, Jesus.